Alright, hello everyone, and welcome back to Let's Play Grandia. I am SIMSteven, also known as Ms. Fenrel. And I would start off by doing a couple of battles first, but there's a few things I missed back in Parm that I want to take care of right away. Let's see here. First we've got a loading screen! And then we've got... come on... Okay, there we go. There's a few things we can do before we, get going with the adventure, I suppose. Let's see here. We've got Lily's Seagull Restaurant, and around here somewhere should be the entrance to the train station. There we go. If you just follow the train tracks overhead, you can kind of follow your way to where you need to be. See this little girl here? See this little girl here with the little pink and purple dress? If you talk to her, she'll give you a little side quest. This is one of those things you can find. It's just easy to miss, I suppose. But anyway, she goes, wah, I hate you, mommy. You, wah. What's wrong, Marie? I can't understand with you crying like that. No, tell me. Sniff, sniff, mommy, drop my pendant, my favorite pin somewhere. Please, just ensue. Will help me look for it. Of course, leave it to me. Oh, really? Thank you. Justin, that's what I thought you'd say. Hehehe, that's sort of embarrassing. So where do you think I lost it? Mommy said it was somewhere around the museum, but I don't know. Somewhere around the museum. All right, let's go look, Sue. And the museum is actually right next door. You see this woman here? Well, this is actually Marie's mother. Now where could it be? I had to find it. I'm really sorry, Marie. She's looking for the pendant too. The pendant is actually right here at the tip of this little triangle pattern on the ground here. So if we look around, right around here. What's that? There it is. This is it. Look, Sue, this is it. Found Marie's pin. Okay, this is the pin that Marie lost. It's really pretty. Quick, we have to go get it to Marie. Ma'am, is this what you're looking for? Is this Marie's pin? Oh, Justin. Now Marie will forgive me, but that girl, she's really mad. Don't worry, man. I'll give it back to her. Marie should be really happy. One thing I should mention is Marie's pin is actually a unique item. If you want to consider a game to be 100% if you have all the items, you would actually stash this away in your stashing place and just leave it there for the rest of the game. However, I would consider 100% to be... doing all the little side quests and getting everything from doing all the little side quests. So I'm going to go give it back to Marie. Hey, Marie, here, let me show you something here. The pin you were looking for. And we give it back. Wow, thank you, Sue and Justin, too. It was no problem at all. Now I can make up with Mommy. I love you all, Justin, too, and Mommy, too. Hey, that rhymes. okay, now if we go back to Marie's mom... Be like, Justin Sue, you found the pin lost. I'm so grateful. I feel guilty. I searched so hard, but no matter what, I couldn't find it. Take this as a token of my appreciation. Justin, you're always skinny, so it'll help. We got some moon cell. Yeah, something that we already have a bunch of because, you know, we started with a bunch and we found, I think, one or two elsewhere. So, yeah, we got a bunch of moon cells now. And, well, there's no real hard or... hard cap or anything or in-game thing for like getting 100% of everything. So don't worry, it's just a user self-defined, however you would define for yourself what 100% would be. And I'd say completing all side quests like that would be the thing to do to get 100%. There's no real reward for doing all that. So anyways, I went into the store here and well, we can go do some shopping. Whenever you're in a store, if you talk to the person behind the counter, you can sell stuff. But I'm not going to sell anything right now. Instead, let's take a bit of a look at the items. You can buy herbs and more wound salve, even though we don't really need either of these. Herbs are less expensive and heal less, but you don't really need them. You'll get a couple for free in a bit. We can buy in the weapon, the women's shop there. Get a ceramic sword. That's actually stronger than the wood sword, but I don't really need that right now. And, well, I can't even afford it, to be honest. I can also buy this metal bat, but again, I already have a mace-type weapon, and I don't really need something that strong just yet. Hand art is something for Sue. Yeah, it's her skill is called Thrown, even though it includes little bows and throwing weapons like hand darts. You know, a dartboard game kind of dart, even though it looks like a shrugging. But yeah. So we don't need really anything from the weapon shop other than, you know, just to upgrade the equipment that we have. And we got the defensive items. So we could buy some. Let's see what we want. We could buy that for Sue. What'll give her the best amount of defense? That'll give her 2 points. That'll give her one. That'll give her one. Don't need the shin shoe. Eventually, I recommend buying 4 of these A sneakers. They're actually Air sneakers, kind of like Air Jordans and all that. Because they are one of the best items for increasing your move. Yeah, this early on in the game. But the move stat is pretty good, but it's not really all that necessary to have a lot of it early on. However, pretty much anyone in the game, including future party members, will be able to equip these things. And it gives a massive boost to move. There's better items much later in the game, but this is one of the better foot items for, I suppose, early on in the game. And for mid-game as well. I'm going to give Sue this sports. Oh, I don't have enough money. I'll probably buy some of those later. But I'm going to buy the light gloves for Sue. And the FL ribbon, whatever that stands for. And I have run completely out of money. But yeah, eventually I'll collect one of everything here in the shop. Once I go out and do some grinding, get some money, of course, and do some more exploring. But we'll probably be in the Parm area for at least a reasonable amount of time, so we got plenty of time to get the money. And if you're like me and like to collect all the items in a game, you can certainly, you know, do some grinding off screen like I will be doing. But there will be plenty of time and plenty of adventures that will be going on before we get that far. Let's see here. Got this house here. House 2 is back over in the part of the town that we started in. And if we go upstairs, there's an old man at a desk. Looks like he's writing a letter. Dear Clara, Mom and Dad have gone to a party again today. So me and Kitty Chimmy are housing on the rose-scented balcony. Excitement fills the night air. What are you doing? What? Oh, phew, it's just you. I'm writing a letter. A letter? It sounds like a letter to a little girl, actually. Clara is a girl my son got to know when he was living in New Parm. She's sickly and hardly ever gets out of the house. She hardly has any friends. Poor girl, I have to write her a letter too. That reminds me, Justin, you're always saying you want to go on an adventure. Have a chance to go to New Parm, please take this letter to Clara. Sure, I'll make sure she gets it. Justin, I won't forgive you if you forget, you won't be forgiven. Okay, so letter to Clara acquired. My dear Clara is a pretty girl. My son said so in a letter. Now, Justin, when you give her the letter, tell her it's from Francoy. Francoy, is that you? My dear Clara is a beautiful 18-year-old girl living in New Parm. That's what it said in the letter. Now, sir, might you have some ulterior motive? If so, I'll never forgive you. Don't be ridiculous, how rude. I have no ulterior motive. But it sounds like when he was writing that letter, he apparently was trying to sound like he was a little girl himself. So I think he does. But then again, it's probably about the same level of, you know, email scams that you get nowadays. Like, hi, I'm a prince from Mongolia, and I'm looking for a wife, and if you want to come over to Mongolia with me, we can get married and you'll be rich. yeah, I don't know anyone who would be stupid enough to fall for something like that. Let's see here. Actually, before I go back on to Marna Road, I want to go to the stashing place and just throw that letter plus a couple other items into the stashing place and, you know, just kind of keep my inventory clean. Because the thing is, each character can hold 12 items maximum, so you really want to make use of the stashing place for a lot of the stuff you get within the game, I suppose. So once I get done organizing my stuff, I'll be right back. All right, and we're back. See, if I go into Justin's items, I only gave him the spirit sword and the wood sword. I'm letting Sue hang on to the intro letter because she seems to be more responsible of the two. and I gave her two of the wound salves, and we got four total wound salves that we just got from, you know, from starting the game and just from getting them around town, and we had an extra sweets item. So, you know, all these items that I have, besides, like, key items like the intro letter, I have at least one of in the stashing place because I consider it to be 100% if I have, or at least for me, I consider it to be 100% if I have at least one of every item in the stashing place. Show off my equipment real quick. The air sneakers, something that you really, really do want to have, because that's a really huge boost to your move stat. And even though move isn't that important of a stat in comparison to things like attack and defense, it's a very huge boost to move just in general. And you want to at least get four of these just for, you know, a good chunk of the game, so all your party members will have this, even the current and future party members. Just kind of like I was saying before. The wood sword I could equip. It is actually stronger than the wood pole that was my default equipment. But the thing is, I'm going to kind of go over what I'm going to do with my skills. The thing is, Sue can also equip some maces as well. So you can see she's got the skill, and so does Justin. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Justin train his mace skill for a while with that wood pole. When I get to about level 3 or level 4, maybe I'm going to switch off to that wood sword and start training that up. Because the thing is, whenever you're training your weapon skills, the amount of points you get per skill, it's based 100 systems, so whenever you get 100 points, you level up your skill. It'll actually start decreasing in how many points you get, because the skill points you get is based on the enemy you're attacking, or your party members, your healing and all that for, you know, healing spells. So, it's like, if I got up to level 10, you know, just theoretically right now, if I got it up to, my message up to level 10, I'd probably be only getting like 1 point per kill, or 1 point per hit whenever I use my mace skill. And, you know, that's if I were to sit around and grind over in the Marna Road. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Justin switch at an earlier level, and then when I get to a later portion in the game, you know, a dungeon that comes in later, or a cave, or a forest, or something like that, not just some simple plain road, I'm going to probably get something else, you know, re-equip the maces, and then I'll be able to increase the level a lot more easier if I just kind of keep all my skill levels at about the same approximate level. And so I'm going to have Sue train her throwing skill, even though it looks like a bow on her status screen. And, you know, once she's gotten that her throwing skill up to a decent level, I'm going to switch Justin to his sword, that wood sword, and I'm going to give Sue that wooden pole. So yeah, it's a good way to spread out how many skill points you get. Let's see here. Yeah. Oh, and you got V slash buff cape. I'll show those off in just a moment. Yeah, we've kind of gone over my items. I've kind of gone over here because one other thing I'm going to point out, which I'm not going to be showing a whole lot of throughout the course of Let's Play, because it'll just take a long time to show like all these little things of dialogue in the game, is that this game is chock full of lots of little funny dialogues between our characters and just all the generic NPCs. It's really well thought out, and, you know, even talking to just some of the generic people in the game ends up, you could find just some very hilarious, you know, lines in the game. And it's like, I could show all these, but this Let's Play would probably be, you know, 100 hours long if I did that. So, yeah, it's a very long game. And it's even longer if you talk to all the generic people. I might show some parts of the sometime. I might show talking to people in some various parts. You know, if I'm in an area with not a lot of people to talk to, I might talk to a few people then. But for the most part, in a big town like this, I'm not going to talk to generic NPCs. But anyways, let's talk to this old guy here. Hey, Justin, can you tell me what today's lunch set is? Special is the surprise mushroom pasta. Coming up, one day special. I didn't exactly order yet. Yeah, that's kind of what I'm talking about. Well, it's all good here, so why not? Looks delicious today. Oh, just like every day. Okay, puppy, I'll share with you too. Puff, puff. But if you keep smacking, you won't be able to eat your dinner. Don't worry about Puffy. He's playing at dinner time to you. That'll be a common thing that we'll see a lot of. Is Puffy's a little bit of a pig, I suppose. He eats a lot. What is it, Justin? I'm busy. Don't bother me. Do you want to help out? Or do you want to help out here? Mom, you look really beautiful today. Where did you learn such sweet talk? I'm busy, sir. If you're not going to help, good. Then get out of the kitchen. Let's do that again. Where'd you learn such sweet talk? Okay, so her portrait isn't so angry this time. Don't bother me. Go out and play outside. Where'd you learn that joke? I know she's winking at us. Don't bother me. I'm busy. Why don't you go play outside? Wait a second, Justin. Here's your allowance. It's only one gold, so don't waste it. And it really does. She really does give us one gold. And you can actually do this as many times as you want if you go out, if you leave the room and come back. No real point to you because you get money a lot faster if you just go out to Marna Road and just kill some monsters there. I'm going to hit save game. I forgot you could do this here, but forgive me. It's been years since I've actually played the game. But that first option there, you can actually go and have dinner again. You don't have to go through the whole dialogue that we saw in the last episode. But, you know, you can always do that. You can frequently do that in throughout the game. So, yeah, you can always have a dinner scene, for the most part, pretty much wherever you want to. You know, as long as there's a place that provides dinner and all that. Anyways, let's go to the Marna Road and just kind of get some exploring and fighting and adventuring out of the way. I'm going to hit recover real quick, since this is faster than just staying and, you know, having the whole dinner scene. So like I said at the end of last episode, and the hint that the save point gets, is you'll see monsters out on the field. And you can see we've got some Marna bugs. I should point out that each and every monster in the field is considered to be a unit, not just that many monsters. You might have seen two Marna bugs pop out of that tree, but it was actually two different units. So we could fight that other set of Marna bugs in another battle. Anyways, let's kind of go over the battle system of Grandia. It's a turn-based battle system, and in my opinion, it's one of the best turn-based systems ever in all of RPGs. First thing I really want to point out is not this command ring that you see me cycling through here, but the bar on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. You can see at the far left side of the bar, it says wait, and at the far right, it says command and action. Command is when you are going to enter your command, so whenever a player character such as Justin or Sue's turns whenever their turn comes up, it'll happen when it reaches that command. There are some actions such as special abilities such like V-slash which are not instant. So you can see that red star underneath the V. As his weapon skills increase, he'll get more stars and that'll increase the speed at which his special abilities will act. So let's use V-slash right now, and you can see Justin's icon on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen went slowly to the right, and if we pick the combo with Sue, she will instantly go to the right because it's a basic action, and there is no wait time on basic commands such as combo. So Justin will use V-slash, and he did quite a bit of damage. Let's see here. Sometimes, so Sue did 11 damage. Sometimes if a character is acting in a combo and their target dies while they're in the middle of the animation, the character might actually hit the nearest target if there's one in range. Because Sue's throwing skill, you know, she shoots an arrow, she usually will not hit an enemy nearby if her target is killed before the arrow reaches the target. So you might want to select the other target. But Justin, however, has a wide swing animation. Justin has a wide swing animation when he, you know, attacks with his mace. So that will allow him to attack a nearby enemy if his target gets killed before his attack is completed. So that's just something to keep in mind, and yeah. Just some basic commands, I suppose. Right there, you see we got a red pouch full of coins. Throughout every area where you can do some combat and fighting, you'll find just basic coin pouches, and you also find red coin pouches like the one I just picked up. The basic ones are green color, and we'll find some of those later. Let's see here. I'm going to have Sue attack that one, because I was saying Justin probably will kill that one, and well, you wanna try and spread out your attacks reasonably well enough. But yeah, I was saying the green coiches are worth less but are more common. The red ones obviously are less common but are worth more. Red coin pouches are always 3 times as much as the green ones, and each area will increase the value of a coin pouch. So 2 battles got me 12 gold from the bugs. Combined with the 1, that means our red coin pouch would be 30 coins, or 30 gold pieces. We can find a green gold pouch. I can kind of show that it is 10 times as much. So here's one right here. If we look at, yep, that's 10 gold pieces from the green coin pouch. In the next area, which will be the Salt Ruins, that value will increase by 10. So the green pouches will be worth 20 gold coins, and the red ones will be worth 60 gold coins. No, there'll always be 30 more. I think there'll always be 30 more, not rather than 3 times as much. I'm probably going to have to test that out when we get to Salt Ruins, but anyways, we attack these centipedes here. As you might have noticed, like, I got an initiative when I came into battle. So that means I was able to attack them before they even saw me. Typically, this is the way you want to do fighting as much as possible whenever you're fighting. Weird way to word that, I suppose. You'll always want to try to get the jump on the enemies whenever possible, and that'll allow you to get some extra damage in, so you don't take as much damage and use healing and all that. Speaking of healing, and the fact that we've taken a few hits here, I'm gonna probably use one of the best moves, not only in this entire game, but one of the best moves in video games ever. Rah-rah, cheer, get ready to laugh.
Come on, puppy! Let's go! Here we go!
I love that it's not attack, but it's healing all the same. It's Puffy and Sue just pull out a bunch of pom-poms and just go, rah-rah, here we go, oh! It actually ends up being a party healing move. So yeah, that's just a bit of a little fun thing to do. Not only is it very useful, but it's very fun to watch. And just another reason why I love this game so much is they throw in a lot of humor everywhere you go in the game. It's just very, very lighthearted and humorous everywhere. Did I say everywhere enough? Anyways, see this blue compass thing here? If you click on it, you stand in the circle and press X, you'll actually get a bird's eye view of your surroundings. So if you're looking for items or where to go, you can use one of those. They're relatively not very helpful, to be honest, but they can be helpful sometimes if you're kind of lost and need to look on where you need to go. We've got some more commands to go through, and that we kind of got the basics under our fingers, I suppose. Let's show off some other things. Just like when Sue and Justin use their special moves, they have a wait time or a charge time before they need to act. Enemies can do this too, and I don't know if we'll see that here, but enemies like the centipede have the ability to use special attacks, and whenever you see an enemy have these glowing stars swirling around them, That means they're charging up a special attack. You can use an ability like critical to cancel that special attack. And the thing about critical moves is they're stronger by nature, but they only hit once. And because they're stronger in nature, they can force the enemy to move farther left on the IP bar, which is a little blue bar on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. The IP bar is the major driving factor between the turn-based system. It tells you when, not only when your character's turn is about to come up, but when your enemy's turn is about to come up. And you can be very devious with how you manipulate the IP bar. We got some herbs here. If you're ever wondering what's an item and what's not, it'll always have little sparklies around the items, or every item you can pick up will have little sparklies on them, so yeah, that's how I knew I could pick up some herbs there. But yeah, as you can see, all the character icons move from left to right, including enemies, and that means that you can actually force an enemy to go farther to the left. If you hit them with a very strong attack or something like a sleep attack, they'll probably be on the far left end. So yeah, you can be very devious with how you manipulate battles, and they tend to be pretty easy this way. Now I'm going to point out the bottom left corner of the screen. You can see it's Justin's turn. It says name Justin, enter command and all that. It says his current hit points and its max hit points. You can also see your current SP and max SP as well as your MP by pressing L2 and R2 on the top of the screen. So you see the character icons. I am cycling between SP and MP and HP. HP is up by default whenever you're not holding down the buttons. But now you see underneath at the bottom left hand corner of the screen, you can see there's a sword, a shield, boots, a running man, and a heart icon. Those are all status boosts or status debuffs. And that's just kind of, whenever you have a buff of some sort, actually I can show this off right now with the Spirit Stone. The Spirit Stone will increase your maximum hit points temporarily for that battle. So you can see Justin's hit points, his maximum are 45. So I'm going to use a Spirit Stone on Justin here just momentarily. It goes boing, and you can see he gains HP level 1. That's a positive level, and you can see now above the heart, it's got an up arrow of 1. You can also see that his hit points have increased from 45 to 49. This also works for reverse, so if an enemy uses a status effect that lowers, say, for example, your defense, there will be a negative or a down arrow and 1 next to that shield. If your defense has been lowered. Same thing goes for movement. And I don't remember the difference between the shoe and the... Oh, I think the difference between the shoe and the running man is... I think the shoe is how fast you move around the field, so your movability. And I believe the running man is how fast your turn comes up. So I believe that's the difference between those two statuses. Speaking of movement, we can actually move around the field. As you can see, we have the ability to... Well, as you can see, there is... Whenever we get into a battle, our characters are placed on a random point around the screen. You can actually move around on the battlefield. If he's not getting hit at the time, you can actually move around on the battlefield. And, that's part of this whole turn-based system, is that attacks will have an area effect. Unlike Sue's Rah-rah cheer, which heals the entire party, there will be moves which, hit a circle. So let's say some guy with a big hammer attacks the area in front of him. If you have a character behind the enemy, he will not get hit by attack, but all other characters that are in range of the hammer slam will get hit by that attack. So it kind of adds a third dimension to an otherwise two-dimensional game, I suppose. At least when you're in combat. that's a few more of the basics. Let's get into another battle. I should also mention that coin that popped out of the enemy. Sometimes you'll see large coin pouches. For the most part, But for the most part, you'll see little coins like the one you see on the experience and golden item screen right here. Whenever an enemy dies, they'll typically drop a small gold coin, but they might also drop an item. Typically, they will not drop money if you get an item instead. So it's kind of like you can tell ahead of time whenever you kill some monsters as to whether or not you got money, no money, or or whether or not you get some items. Typically, it's usually only one or the other, but some boss fights, for example, a boss might have multiple parts, and like the body might drop some money. And let's say we're fighting a Hydra. So we got a Hydra, we got like three heads, you kill each head, and one might drop an item, one might drop some money, and another might drop a weapon or something like that. You'll actually see that on screen before you actually finish the battle. And in the case of such as a boss fight, the money pouch might be a preset amount. So it's kind of like you'll get a bunch of money from fighting the boss and some equipment as well. So just something to be aware of is why these things pop up on the screen and all that. So yeah. Oh, you can see that one over there has sparklies. He's about to use a special attack. If I had seen that early, I could have used my critical strike, or I could have used a strong move such as Puffy Kicked, but I have to actually use some of my SP to use that. But I could have canceled his Thorn attack right there if I had seen that ahead of time. In addition, I should also point out, well, this isn't a good time to point that out, actually, but I'll talk about that in just a minute in the next battle. But for now, let's finish this fight, get some money and some experience. And, oh, by the way, one other thing I should mention is Justin starts off at level 2 while Sue starts off at level 1. I'm not actually gaining any levels, but I did gain a skill level for both of them in this fight. So, let's go in the skill screen and just kind of take a look at that. So, as you can see, by leveling up Justin's maces and his vitality, his hit points and his vitality went up by 1. Sue also had an increase to her hit points and strength, thanks to leveling up her bow skill. So if we take a look at Justin, his hit points did actually increase there, because he hasn't actually leveled up yet. We saw in an earlier battle that he had 45 hit points. Now he has 47. So it's a very good idea to level up as many skills as you possibly can in order to make certain characters stronger. So yeah, battle is good then. So yeah, you'll probably want to do some grinding every now and then. I'm not going to fight every single battle here, just the ones that are between me and items and all that. But yeah, it might be a good idea to just hang around, kill everything in the battle map the first couple times you're hanging around there. In addition to this, something I've said before, you might have noticed earlier that after Sue had used her Rah-rah cheer, she had around 6 SP, or I believe it's skill points. I don't think it's skill points, but it might be standing for something else, something different, I suppose. But you can see she now has 15. I'm going to hopefully try and show this. It's also one reason why you want to use combos. At least I think that's one. At least I think I got this right. Let's see here. I'm going to use critical just because I want to confirm this for myself. Whenever you attack, you'll gain SP back. So SP will recharge slowly over time as long as you keep attacking. I think it might also increase if you're defending and you get hit. But don't quote me on that, I'm not entirely sure. But I want to see if critical increases 1 or 2 points. Okay, it does increase 2 points. Each hit from a combo will increase your SP by 1, and it looks like each hit from a critical will also increase your... Well, not increase it by 1, but increase it by 2 whenever you get hit with a critical. So it's important to remember, because later on the game, spoilers, you'll actually get equipment that can increase your number of combo hits by one, or number of your critical hits by one. So you could actually do two criticals in a row and get 4 SP back. Whereas, you know, if you combo with 3, you might actually get 3 SP back. Helpful information to know, but not too useful to us now. Okay, so in the last next thing. Last battle I said it, I wanted to show something off about the IP bar at the bottom right. You can see that the centipede there is on standby. Whenever you cross that little marker past that's halfway through between wait and calm, it's just left where Sue is right now. An enemy will choose their attack then during that halfway point. However, characters like Sue, who is player controlled, will not have that. But whenever an enemy crosses that halfway point, they will decide their command, so you already know what they're going to be doing. And you can act appropriately to cancel their attack. So if one of those centipedes were to start using Thorn, whenever they cross that halfway marker, you will actually see them charging it up at that point, rather than when they get all the way to the command portion. So yeah, you can actually cancel their attacks earlier on. And you could just kind of see at that point if you want to. You can use that to decide what attacks you're going to use and when. You can always cancel attacks. Some are very, very hard to do. Okay, sorry for being a bit too quiet there, and for cutting off what I was saying. I actually wanted to let you hear the music there, because whenever we get ambushed, the music actually gets a bit more intense. Even though our speed is a lot higher than these bugs, we actually manage to reach the command around the time they're starting to act. Whenever you get ambushed, meaning they touched Sue's sprite in the field, whenever you get ambushed, the music will change and your enemies will be farther along or farther to the right on the IP bar. Whereas, excuse me, I got a sore throat. I need to take a drink real quick. All right, I'm back. So as I was saying, whenever you start by getting ambushed, our characters will be on the far left side. The enemies will be on the far right, quite the opposite of, well, the exact opposite of whenever you get an initiative attack. That's something you got to be aware of, is you can't always run and get away with it. we still beat them before they actually manage to do damage. However, I should also point out, you might have seen a little message pop up just there that said counter. Whenever you're attacking and they're attacking, and it's kind of like, bullfighting, you know, butting heads and all that. Whenever the player characters and whenever your party members and an enemy attack each other at the same time, the animation will take priority, but whenever you see that counter message, it means that you'll actually take a bit of damage. It's just a small, minor amount of damage, but... Or I think it means that you got in and canceled. I can't remember. Actually, I can't remember what the counter is. I thought what it meant is that you'll take a bit of damage whenever you get countered. But it doesn't look like that's the case. I actually took a look on the stats screen momentarily, and just the hit points had not changed. So I gotta really figure out what that did again, because I thought I was gonna take damage there. Maybe it means you just gotta attack in before they did. I'm not really sure. I really don't know what that meant. Okay, now I get a chance to show this off. I can see that Marna bug is using an attack called String Orb. If I use a critical here, I can actually, well, if he survived that attack, it would have popped up with another message bubble that would have said cancel, because I would have been able to knock him far enough left on the IP bar to cancel his attack and put him back into standby. But because of the fact that I actually killed him with that attack, yeah, you didn't actually get to see that. But, you know, that will be handy in the future. I know there's something else around here. But anyways, let's go into some more battle mechanics, just kind of show things off. And I don't want to drag things out too much, showing me doing a bit of grinding and all that. Defend, I kind of showed evasion earlier, in that you can actually move around the field, and there is, well, pretty much the standard defend in most RPGs. You don't attack, but you cut the damage you take in half, typically. I think that's going to be the same in this area. The look command basically lets you take a look at all the enemies and see, you know, their hit points and what action they're about to take. Because they're still not past that halfway mark, they're on standby, so I don't know what they're going to do. Escape, pretty obvious. You hit that and your characters will run for a few seconds before escaping. I think if I were to pick that with Sue, once she'll slowly move from command to action, and once it reaches action, we'll run from the battle. Pretty basic. Using items, also pretty basic. Moves of magic. We've shown most of these. I have not shown Puffy Kick, so might as well show that here while we're at it. And while we're here, we got one last menu item here. Tactics. If you want to just do some auto battle, just go in here and press R, and you'll go into Party Tactics. You can also set things up here, so it'll actually continue from battle to battle. You can also set it up so that one character will always be auto battling. So if, let's just say that Justin doesn't really have much use other than attacking enemies right now. I could set him up to play fair, and he'll use normal attacks. I could also set him to use Go Wild, and whenever... excuse me... Whenever he has 14 SP, which is enough to use V-Slash, he'll use that instead of normal moves. Otherwise, he'll just use basic attacks to build up his SP. Let's see here. Power up, you'll use abilities to buff your stats. Mini, do the exact opposite. Withdraw, you'll basically defend and run around the field. Safety is basically you use healing magics and abilities to restore your party. Otherwise, they'll defend. AI move, let the character decide. Just basically let the AI decide what to do in whatever situation. But yeah, if you really just want to sit around and grind for a while, you'll just use play fair, like so. And you'll have that at the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. And that was Puffy Kick. She goes, go do it! And Puffy just goes and attacks the enemy like crazy.
What a cinch!
Alright, and one other thing I should point out, you see, or you heard Justin say, what a cinch just there. I don't know. I don't know what that means, but I could see Justin said, what a cinch. At the end of the battle, just kind of something they did for, you know, to add a little bit of flavor, is... Your characters will say different things based on how well the battle went. Oh, by the way, we're still in auto battle right now. Whenever you... If you win a battle pretty much flawlessly, you know, one turn, the enemies don't do really anything, or they don't do damage to you or anything like that, your characters will probably be like, pretty easy, Puffy, or what a cinch, in terms of what Justin and Sue will say. But let's say the battle dragged on really, really long, and there's Sue said hip hip hooray. So we took damage. That's basically the normal thing. But if you had like a party member die in battle, or it went on for a really, really long time. Let's say you were leveling up a magic skill, you could just hang around in battle. And healing everything, and if you take a ton of damage during that battle, Your perfect character might say something like, "Are you okay, Puffy?" or something like that. And so, yeah, they have different battle quotes at the end of each battle. So, yeah, I think I've kind of gone over pretty much everything I really need to talk about with just battles in general. So, I suppose from now on, I'll probably show a few random battles per each area. You know, just kind of show off a few of the enemies and all that. But other than that, I am probably just going to cut out most battles that I get into, just kind of explore each area. Because I really haven't said much about, like, all the items I've been picking up. I picked up a couple herbs and coins, you know, just kind of pointless stuff and all that. But I suppose for now, we can just kind of get going and go exploring. And I'll probably start cutting out a bunch of the battles. This here, it looks kind of like a flask or something. This is actually a satchel. It could literally be anything. It could be a herb, it could be a weapon, it could be a piece of armor. So whenever you see something like that, pick it up, because you'll definitely want to get any satchel item like that. It's kind of like, you won't know what it is until you get it, but it's always going to be the same thing no matter how many times you play through the game. It's just, you can't really tell just by looking at it, and I get ambushed again. How lovely. But yeah, you want to explore every area fully, because you can get cool items like a baton there. And that's actually stronger than the wood pole that I have, so I might just give that to Sue now that we've... I'm going to do one or two more battles so that Justin can get his mace skill, and then I'm going to give the baton... Actually, I'll give the baton right now to Sue. You know, just put it in her inventory, and when she levels up her throwing skill, because even though she's using a bow, it's called a throwing skill. Gotta reiterate that several times. I'll just give that to her and put it in her inventory, and she'll use the baton while Justin will use the wood pole. Now, it's an officer's baton, so you'd think that the military would have passed through this area. And so, yeah, they did. So, as we saw in the intro cutscene of the game, the Gargoyle forces, which basically are the military of this game, they went to the Salt Ruins as well. So we'll probably be seeing some of them when we get there. But, you know, we'll get there when we get there, I suppose. But yeah, I think I've explored pretty much everything here. I swear there was another thing of herbs somewhere around. No, I got both herbs. Never mind, I got them both. Yeah, I didn't even acknowledge when I picked those up. Yeah, that trend seems to be continuing from Mega Man Legends. Yeah. Cutting battle. Yeah, that trend seems like it's continuing from Mega Man Legends. I really gotta get better at doing that. One last thing before we end this episode off here at the Salt Ruins. See, I exited out through that exit there, and, yeah, pretty obvious, but just saying that. Notice the compass at the top right-hand corner of the screen. The compass will point you to the next exit, when you're, like, in a dungeon area like this. When you're in town, it'll actually just kind of slowly rotate in circles. But when you're in an area like this where you have to pass through, it'll actually point either from one exit to the other. If you press R2 when you're in the field, you can change what exit you want it to point to. So it's a very good idea to use the compass, because an area might have three exits, which might lead to some items in the secret exit. And so if you explore around, you might actually find an area with more items in it. So yeah, that's just another thing worth mentioning. But anyways, we're here in the Salt Ruins, and I think we can save the game here. We can also go back to Parm and save the game there, and we can actually skip the Marna Road on our way to the Salt Ruins. Let's see, we're getting a bird's eye view of the excavation site, and there's a lot of military commanders and soldiers down there. I'll be quiet since we got some important characters here. Or at least I think... No, I don't think they'll actually do the voice acting cutscene until we actually go in a little bit further. So, yeah, even though voice acted cutscenes are far and few between, I don't think this is one of the probably the last few times we'll have a voice acted cutscene for a while. But I think since I saw the save point down there, and I want to end off this episode right now, I'm actually going to go back to Parm, and we'll save there at Lily Seagull Restaurant. So, because I went into Parm from, I can actually go back into Marna Road, and and whenever you enter an area, it'll think that you came in from the previous area you went. So, if I went into Salt Ruins and went into Marna Road, I wouldn't come out at the exit side, rather than the entrance side. Whereas if I go into Parm, go back out and go into the Marna Road, I'll be back at that save point on the other side of the road. So, yeah, just a quick and easy way if you want to manipulate, you know, what side you come into. And that'll allow us to save the game. It's spent forever loading the save files so we can get, just so we can save the game. Yeah, this is going to get a bit annoying. Probably for me, and if you're playing around along with multiple save files, probably gonna get annoying for you too, because it's gotta load each file and, you know, give you an information on each save file before you actually are able to do anything on the screen. But anyways, we saved the game and we've explored the Marna Road, we've done some side quests in Parm, so now we're going to head off to the Salt Ruins in the next episode. So I guess I will see you guys later, and I need another drink so I can, my throat is very freaking dry after talking all this time. So, I will see you guys later. Thanks for watching.